It's time for Thursday Night Thunder tonight on MLB The Show from Arm & Hammer Park. Tonight, the Trenton Thunder and the Binghamton Rumble Ponies continue their 2020 virtual season. Alongside Shawn Semple, I'm John Moses. Brady LaDon is with us for the first couple innings here tonight. We will take a moment now to have tonight's national anthem here at Arm & Hammer Park.
Today's Thunder Field of Dreams team is the Robbinsville Little League. Presenting the colors today in right field is Cub Scout Pack 577. Fans, please remain standing, remove your caps, veterans, please salute, and welcome the Steinert High School and Reynolds Middle School choirs as they honor America with the performance of our national anthem.
It's time for Thursday Night Thunder as right-hander Nick Nelson makes the start. You see the season numbers for Nelson as we work into late May here in the virtual season on MLB The Show. Strong numbers for Nelson, excellent fastball, very good curveball, a slider that came a long way last season. And Jacob Zanin will lead it off for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies tonight, New York Mets AA affiliate. The right-hand batter stands in there. Nelson's first offering is on the way, and we are underway tonight on Thursday Night Thunder. Starting lineup presented by Kia. Center fielder Jacob Zanin leads off, followed by the designated hitter Jeremy Vasquez. Second baseman Andres Jimenez bats third, then Brett Beatty, the first baseman. Ronnie Mauricio, the shortstop, bats fifth, followed by left fielder Tim Tebow batting sixth. As Zanin fouls one away, third baseman Shervin Newton bats seventh. Quinn Brody in right field bats eighth. And then Austin Bosark behind the plate batting ninth for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies. Well, Shawn Semple, you had some time to hang out with Nick Nelson over the last couple of years. What does Nick bring to the table?
Nick brings an absolute rocket arm to the table. And a rocket arm as in a high velo and absolute crazy breaking balls. So, I mean, Rumble Ponies definitely going to have a hard time today.
Well, quick work of Jacob Zanin to start the game as Jeremy Vasquez lines one to the second baseman. That's caught by Hoy Park.
Yeah, it's risky. It's the first pitch of the game, breaking ball. You got to love it. You got to love how he dumped it in there.
Have you ever thrown a first pitch breaking ball in a game, Shawn?
I have.
To start a game, really?
Oh, to start? No. But that just shows Nick. He's got 97 just hanging in there. He throws an 80 mile an hour breaking ball right in there for first pitch strike of the game.
Andres Jimenez at the plate now for the Rumble Ponies. Speedy infield prospect, one of the younger players in the Eastern League a season ago.
Did Nick dye his hair?
It's a good question. It is definitely different.
Yeah, maybe it's, trying to get out of a bad funk or something like that.
I am a little surprised, and we're doing this over Zoom, Shawn, so I get to see your face. I'm a little surprised to see no beard as Nelson makes quick work of Jimenez, and it's a 1-2-3 first inning for the Thunder.
I don't like the beard. I'm not a big beard person.
You wouldn't wear any facial hair if you had the choice?
A mustache, but I can't grow a mustache. I grow the best Andrew Luck neck beard.
Thomas Zapucki is the starting pitcher for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies tonight. Kia starting lineup for Trenton this evening. Right fielder Zach Zahner will lead off, followed by left fielder Trey Ambergy and center fielder Esteban Florial. Brandon Wagner, the first baseman, is in the cleanup spot, followed by Hoy Park, the second baseman. Chris Gittens, the designated hitter tonight, bats sixth. And catcher Kellen Deglin, third baseman Max Burt, and Angel Aguilar at shortstop for the Thunder. Zahner checks his swing at the first offering and takes low for ball one.
Good take. Zahner's usually rocking the Jordans. I think he's got New Balance on right now.
Those do look like New Balances for Zahner. Yeah. We'll have to talk to him about that. Perhaps next week.
I want to talk to him too.
No balls and two strikes. And the pitch home is swing and a miss for strike three. First out here in the bottom of the first inning. So, Shawn, how have you sort of spent your time during quarantine these last couple of weeks where we're sort of all inside now for about a month?
So, honestly, I've been kind of doing the same thing I would do any off season. I still can go in, get my workouts in and my throwing in, but I'm just like doing higher reps and like stuff like that to maintain what I would do during the season. And I play a lot of video games too. So about it. And Zoom calls, whenever I can, I do Zoom calls with younger baseball players that work with my trainer. And about it. But baseball, I've been watching a lot of just highlight videos. I'm just like, I feel like I'm in limbo without baseball. I feel like, I don't even know. It's just such a weird feeling. Like I don't know what to do with myself.
Well, here's Trey Ambergy with a base hit to left field. Solid stroke from Trenton's left fielder. And we got a quick look at Bat Dog Rookie pulling a bat back to the dugout.
Will we get a special appearance from Dash today?
I am not sure that Dash is ready to start retrieving bats, Shawn, but... Yeah. Hey, you can follow him on Instagram.
Yeah, I totally can.
Esteban Florial at the plate for the Thunder. Center fielder's had a solid campaign. His maiden voyage at AA, swings and shoots one foul down the left field line. Now, you mentioned you're spending some time on Zoom calls talking to younger players with your trainer. Can you tell us more about that? How did you get involved with this specific trainer, and what kind of knowledge are you sharing with some younger baseball players these days?
Yeah, so there's three guys I like grew up with in New Jersey with baseball who I've met. So it went from my travel coach, his name was Frank Nicolosi, and he introduced me to a man named Sean Bussey who worked with me to get like lose weight and stuff like that in high school. Then I met another guy named CJ Appenzeller. He's the guy I've been training with the last couple of off seasons, and he doesn't charge me a dime. Like people do pay to use his services, and because he's fantastic. And I've never met anybody better than what he does. It's the type Eric Cressy type workouts and stuff. But he has a lot of younger guys who work with him, and, I'm always here, and I'm always appreciative of him letting me work out with him and him helping me, so I don't mind ever helping out his young guys.
One ball and one strike to Brandon Wagner. He swings and taps one foul at the plate for strike two. A walk drawn by Esteban Florial. First inning opportunity here for the Thunder. A 1-2 pitch. It's fouled away again by Wags.
They got Wags' pretty hair in here. I see it flowing out the back.
A 1-2 pitch. Swung on and crushed. Deep right field. way back there and gone. It's a three-run home run for Brandon Wagner.
Oh, Wags. Doesn't matter if Corona's here. He's still going to hit bombs.
A Hyundai home run for Brandon Wagner, his sixth round tripper of the season, and a first inning lead for the Thunder.
Speaking of his hair, who do you, in your opinion, has the best hair on the Trenton Thunder?
That's a tough one. That's a tough one because Wags has got good hair. I'm trying to think some other guys. I'm thinking Kyle Holder's always got nice hair. Zaner's got nice hair. Some people will say that Nelly's got nice hair, and some people, you know, will mess with him a little bit. But I'm gonna have to go with probably Wags because he's just been consistent. You know, it's just like flows straight back. It's never messed up, like no matter what.
Yeah, I remember Holder having really nice flow, and yeah. If he could let it go, then it could really be something.
Definitely, he has like the typical like base, not typical, but like everyone's got the high and tight, but he makes it look way cooler than anyone else. I mean, but like Wags just got like the flow and hair, like it doesn't matter what it is, it just always like somehow looks good and shapes up well under a baseball cap.
Pitch to Chris Gittens is outside and low for ball one.
I have a feeling that Giddy's going to go long here, too, just go back to that.
Chris Gittens, the league's most valuable player last year. Swings and fouls one away off to the first base side.
I don't think I've ever seen a raw hitter in my own eyes than Chris Gittens. And it's funny, like, I look at him, and I grew up playing with Kanan Smith in the younger GCL and low A, and I just see like that raw hitter in both of them, like that Tony Gwynn, like just will hit anything hard anywhere. And hey, look at them both from last year. You get a low A player of the year and a double A player of the year, so sure the Yankees know something.
David Rodriguez pinch hitting here to open second inning for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies here on Thursday Night Thunder. Nick Nelson back to the mound. Now, Shawn, you know, you mentioned New Jersey. I mean, you know, some fans may know that you grew up in South Jersey. Sort of, mm-hmm. What was that experience like growing up in high school and playing baseball in the Garden State?
Hey, I always enjoyed it, you know. Always loved playing baseball in the Garden State until I went to college in the South State, and it was never cold on opening day. But hey, high school, I love baseball. You know, I love New Jersey. I love New Jersey because it breeds absolute bulldogs. No one else breeds bulldogs in baseball like New Jersey does. So, you know, there's one thing. And then just to, you know, be around Trenton growing up and then playing there this year, It was unreal. It was such a surreal moment of my life and my career. Definitely my favorite like moment of my career so far in baseball.
Base hit down the left field line from David Rodriguez, a leadoff base runner for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies here in the second inning. I'm curious about the coldest game you've ever pitched in your life.
I'm trying to think. So my junior year, we were postponed our first game because it got snowed out. And I'm trying to think, we played a game against Ocean City, I want to say. And it was home in Haddonfield, New Jersey, where I went to school. It was called Paul Six. And I'm pretty sure it was like 38 degrees when we played. And I think that might be the coldest game I've ever been in.
Oh,
and I think it would be the last. I mean, I'm hoping it's the last one. You know, I mean, I know Trenton gets up, you know, gets down there in the beginning of the season, but I mean, sadly not there right now. It's the field.
Yeah, I was just saying, you know, we could very easily be in Erie here in April and early May. And
I heard about that last year. First game of the season in Erie. What are they thinking?
I remember we were out there in 2018, and we got snowed out. I got a text message from Erie's AGM and radio broadcaster, Greg Gagne, about 12:30 or 1 o'clock. He was like, hey, man, you can probably stop doing game notes. It's not looking like we're going to play today.
Yeah. It's tough. Like, I mean, but it's beautiful in the summer. Absolutely beautiful in the summer.
It's true. Tim Tebow at the plate for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies here in the second inning. Shawn Semple with us here on Thursday Night Thunder. Social media coordinator and on-field MC Brady Ledon with us as well, dropping in some questions that you, the fans, submitted through Instagram and Twitter. Brady, do you have another question for Shawn?
I do. This question is from Yankee Source, and they ask, who was your favorite player to watch while you were growing up?
I've gotten this before, and I think as a baseball player, it's only fair that you have a favorite position player and a favorite pitcher, because you can't, you know, they're different. So growing up, I was a big Phillies fan. So my favorite two players growing up were definitely Chase Utley as a position player, and I'd say Roy Halladay as a pitcher.
Yeah, I share a lot of that with you. I mean, I grew up in Philadelphia also, and you know, I skipped 2 days of college classes to go to the Phillies parade in 2008. Hard not to love the way Chase Utley played the game.
Yeah, I mean, and you know, everyone's going to have their reaction to, you know, the dirty slide that he did in the playoffs, but that's baseball. I'm sorry, you know, it's baseball, and I'm really sorry about the guy. I forget who it was. Was it Wilmer Flores? I think got hurt, and you know, sorry Wilmer, but that's baseball.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Daniel Murphy turned into a postseason hero for the Mets that year, and that certainly wouldn't have happened without the slide.
Yep. Totally, I didn't even think about that. But yeah, Chase Utley, 100% favorite player. 2009 World Series against the Yankees, I will never forget, but I won't bring it up because obviously I'm a Yankee fan too, and that's just me.
Well, another question similar to that one. Who's your favorite baseball player to watch right now playing the game?
Right now, definitely off the top of my head, definitely Scherzer. I love Max Scherzer. I mean, I wish I could throw as hard as he can, but I definitely am trying to put as much effort as he does into his pitches, and that's why I love him, because he just gives everything he's got. It just, like, every pitch he's got, he's grunting, he's, you know, just throwing everything with conviction, and I just think any pitcher should just relate to him in any way of throwing, because that's how any pitcher should be. You got to go out there and you just got to give everything you got.
I mean, how intimidating must it be to bat against him? I mean, the guy's got two different eye collars. He looks like he wants to just, you know, rip your heart out with his bare teeth, and you know, he's just probably the most intimidating presence I could ever imagine.
Oh, yeah. I could not imagine. Like, it kind of freaks me out sometimes watching him on the mound. It's like, is that guy, like, crazy or what? But no, that's honestly, on the mound, like, you got to be a madman. I mean, with control, but, you know, you got to be a madman. It's Mad Max.
Liner to deep right field off the bat of Quinn Brody is over the head of Zach Zehner, one bouncing off the wall. It's an RBI double as Brody slides in safely, and the Rumble Ponies have a pair of runs on the board here in the second inning. Thunder pitching coach Travis Phelps on his way to the mound to visit with Nick Nelson. And here it's what's turning into a bit of a lengthy second inning for Nelly. Just a quick conversation here to try to settle him in and get out of the second inning without further damage. Austin Bosar, catcher for Binghamton, is up next. Nelson's first offering to him is fouled away for strike one.
Probably the high cheddar there.
Well, when you have that good fastball, you got to live up there with it.
You gotta let it eat. Definitely gotta let it eat.
Little number back to the pitcher, knocked down by Nelson, and he won't have a play on the infield, so the Rumble Ponies will have men on the corners in the top of the order. Jacob Zannon coming to the plate.
It's a tough one. That's why we gotta practice those PFPs all the time. just to make sure.
Fastball strike at the top of the zone to Zanin. Is that a favorite drill for you, Shawn, to do PFPs?
I don't mind PFPs at all. You know, we only throw every day, and that's all we do. So if anyone ever, like whines about doing PFPs, it's like, why? Like, what, are you just going to go sit inside and do nothing? At least just, like, get some throws in and be an athlete once in a while. I enjoy doing them because, you know, it puts me in a game situation. I drop my arms down a little bit, and I always am a big fan of PFPs. I've always liked doing PFPs. Because, you know, I like to act like a fielder. I don't want to act like a pitcher all the time. Like, I am athletic. I want people to know that.
What do you think's the most athletic play you've ever done on a baseball field?
In my eyes, it was athletic, but in other people's eyes, it looked like I was a flopping fish. So in the GCL championship, actually, there was a bunt pop-up bottom of the ninth with the men on first and third, I believe. And I'm running, and I dive, and I miss it. But I hustle for it, and I miss it, and I get up, throw from one knee all the way to second base and get the guy at second and the guy at third stays. So that's probably one of my most athletic plays I could think of. Probably the only time I've ever dove off a mound, but I wish I caught it instead of, you know. Yeah. But I still got him at second, so it's all right. That's definitely my favorite PFP. I think the most athletic PFP I've ever done.
Bottom half of the second inning here on Thursday Night Thunder. Trenton leading at 3-2. Shawn Semple is with us. Brady Ladon, our promo coordinator, social media coordinator, on-field MC, you name it, Brady does it. She's got some questions for Shawn Semple from Instagram and Twitter submitted by fans. Brady, you got another question for Shawn?
I do. We got a ton of questions about pitching. First off, what is your favorite pitch to throw?
My favorite pitch to throw is my fastball, definitely. I just love getting people to swing through it up in the zone.
And what about your worst pitch? What do you hate to throw and wish you didn't have to?
One ball, one strike.
Well, the thing is, I don't hate to throw it, but I love throwing my curveball and changeup as well, but sometimes they're inconsistent to make me want to hate them, but when they're going, they're good. But it's definitely, you don't want to, like, hate a pitch because then it's, like, in your head mentally that you can't throw it. So you want to, like, be like you love it. But that's definitely a pitch that I love / hate is my curveball because sometimes it's great and then sometimes it's over the fence every time.
I mean, I guess this is a question, you know, in general for pitchers, you know, how often are you sort of like tinkering with your repertoire and looking to add something else or change what you're doing with a certain breaking ball?
I mean, always. I've been, you know, messing around with my curveball, I don't know, ever since I really tried developing them in high school. But over the last couple of years of pro ball, I've been able to talk to more people and learn more things. And, yeah, I mean, I'm still tinkering around. I still tinker with my pitches all the time just to see if I can get more movement this way or more movement on my changeup and move my finger over a little bit. So it's every day. When you're in catch play, we're always trying new things. But, you know, if you have a good feel of what you like for that pitch, I mean, there's no reason to tinker with it. But me trying to still complete these pitches and throw them consistently. I'm constantly tinkering with my pitches.
I guess another question is about sort of some of the resources that, you know, the New York Yankees have for their minor league and major leaguers, you know, both position players and pitchers. You know, there's extensive video catalogs, you know, video rooms at every affiliate that you can watch yourself. I'm curious, you know, are there certain metrics or certain, you know, analytics, if you will, that, you know, sort of help teach you about how effective your pitches are and maybe can help you make an adjustment? And is that something that you're sort of learning from your coaches as often, as much as you are from the computer?
Yeah, so immediately when I got drafted by Yankees, they were all about, you know, sports science and pitching signs. So I was immediately in on it. I love everything to do with pitch signs because, I mean, it's there to get you better. People don't like looking at it because maybe they don't have good numbers. I don't have the best numbers on my breaking pitches, but you know that there's machines called like the Rapsodo and then the Edgetronic cameras that are very slow cameras will like show you where you're releasing it, and then the Rapsodo will tell you like the spin rates and like how efficient your ball is moving, like my fastball. So I know I have a good fastball because it tells me my efficiency is 100 and it's got good spin rate. So, but now I know that. But back in the day, I didn't know that. And it made me want to know even more because it has helped me evolve as a pitcher for sure. Like the Rapsodo, you can go out there and you can have a bullpen where you focus on, you know, just one pitch, like a curveball, which I've done plenty of times. And if you're just trying to replicate something and you finally get it on the screen, it'll show you what it looks like. So you just try to replicate that. Growing up, I never had anything to help me like that. And over the last 2 years, I'm definitely the biggest adjustment in my breaking pitches. And they've gotten so much better, you know, and consistent using these technology that is just opening the baseball in the last couple of years. I'm just honestly really excited to see where it's going to go in the next 2 years. You know, the Yankees just got they call it the gas station. Yeah, I didn't name it. But it's awesome. It's awesome. It's got like the plyo walls to throw the weighted balls at. It's got five mounds with five edgetronic cameras with five Rapsodos and like a huge like screen behind to blow it up and watch your video. It's next level. That's for sure.
Wow, the gas factory. I love it.
Gas station.
Oh, excuse me, the gas station. Yeah. Well, yeah. Makes sense. You just fill it up a little bit and take it out on the road with you.
It helped me throw a little bit harder. And I was throwing pretty hard in spring training. I was all in on the gas station.
I think that's one thing that can sort of help set organizations apart. I think you're starting to speak to some of these things about, you know, what makes playing for the New York Yankees unique. Is there anything else that sort of sticks out to you that maybe the average fan might not know?
They just treat us with like the most respect. Like I hear some like pretty horror stories, you know, everyone does about here in the minor leagues and some people don't have the best stuff. But there's never been a time where I wasn't like, oh, the Yankees are like screwing us here, you know? Like I respect everything that they do for us as minor league players. And like I was in Staten Island 2 years ago, and I'm not saying it's the best field ever in Staten Island, but they made it the best it possibly could be.
The Central Buck South Titans entered the playoffs as the 17th seed out of 20. They went on to win four road games before falling in the district championship 2-1. In the state playoffs, the Titans beat teams from all over the state. In the semifinals, a 9-run sixth inning secured their trip to the state championship. CB South finished the season 19-8 overall after falling to Souderton in the state championship. The 2019 CB South baseball team is the first male sport to play for a state title in school history while achieving the best baseball season in the school's 12-year existence. Now, fans, let's meet the players and coaching staff of the Central Bucks South Titans. Carter Hines, Joe Martino, Andrew Wheeler, Ryan Zakruski, Jake McKeown, Brock Beat, Michael Marino, Kevin Gillard, Ryan Reber, Owen Petrich, Dakota Beck, Jake Trachtenberg, Joey Loind, and Gavin Anderson. The head coach is Brian Klump. The assistant coaches are Phil Wersta, Nick Vitelli, and Ed Zakarowicz. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for the Central Bucks South baseball team for a great season.
Middle of the third inning here on Thursday Night Thunder. We're visiting with Shawn Semple, South Jersey's own. And, you know, being South Jersey's own, you know, are you thrilled with what the Philadelphia Eagles have done in the offseason?
We need a big receiver. That's all we need. Because our defense is getting better. You know, they re-signed Mills, and then they picked up, what's his name, from the Lions.
Oh, Darius Slay, yeah.
Slay, yeah. I mean, and then, you know, we got Cox. We have a solid defense, and, you know, I think they'll figure it out. We need Wentz. You know, we need him to stay healthy. I love Wentz. Clowney had the dirtiest hit of the year last year, and no one called it. I'm happy with the way they're going, obviously. You know, they won a Super Bowl. We have to be happy. We have to be happy for at least 5 years after our Super Bowl. Because, you know, we just witnessed greatness, you know?
Hey, man, you know, happiness and Philadelphia sports fans, like, just don't really go together. Come on, man.
No, it's either, like, make or break year by year. It doesn't matter if you won a Super Bowl the year before. If you don't get back to the playoffs that next year, you're Doug Peterson might get fired, you know? Like, you never know. Coaches are always in the hot seat in the Philly.
You know, we're taping this on Tuesday afternoon here, and, you know, news has just come out about a member of the Steinbrenner family passing away. And, you know, I think that, you know, for those of us that grew up watching baseball and following baseball in the Northeast Corridor, I mean, the Steinbrenner name sort of looms over all of it. And you can't tell the story of baseball without talking about that family. So it's certainly been a hard day to be connected to the Yankees organization.
Yeah, definitely. And too, like, in 2017, we won the GCL championship. Like, we won the whole thing. So the next year in spring training, we had Hal, he was there, and I'm pretty sure Hank was there too, and Ginny Steinbrenner, and like they were all there, and it was just like the lowest level won a championship, but they were all there, and it just shows you like how much respect that they have for every affiliate for the Yankees. And it's just, you know, it's just a shame, you know, what happened. But, like, everyone knows who Steinbrenner is. I mean, like, I couldn't tell you any other owners or any other families within a baseball or even within any sporting. I mean, Jerry Jones is the only one I could really think of anyone who owns the teams or deals with them. But Steinbrenner, I mean, they're on Seinfeld, you know, they're on anything. Steinbrenner has been around forever, and everyone knows that name. So it's just, you know, everyone's connected to it. No matter if you're a Yankee fan or not, you just got to, you know, you're going to mourn a little bit, you know, about such a great family and such a historic family of what, you know, they built. And, you know, it's always sad to see that come out and gone.
Infield single here for Brandon Wagner. Thunder again threatening here in the bottom half of the third inning with two away. Coy Park will come to the plate next. It is 3-2 Trenton here in the bottom half of the third inning. Zapuki's delivery is in there for a strike at the top of the zone. Well, Hoy Park putting together another solid campaign here in 2020. See the average near 330, an Eastern League All-Star last year. And the pitch is in the dirt, but the catcher Bosart keeps it in the area and counts one ball, one strike.
A good player too, Hoy right there. The team guy. I couldn't imagine, you know, the barriers that he dealt with coming over, but now you talk to him, he understands. It's absolutely insane. Like when you talk to him and how the way he knows English and how quickly he learned English, gotta give it to him. Plus, being a fantastic second baseman. I mean, come on, boy, just show us the secret.
Two balls and two strikes with two away, and the pitch is swung on and bounced toward the right side of the infield. Second baseman Jimenez has it, and the inning comes to an end. On we go to the fourth inning here on Thursday Night Thunder, presented by NJM Insurance. Thursday Thursday Night Thunder continues here in the top half of the fourth inning. Trenton leading at 3-2. Ronnie Mauricio, the shortstop, will lead off for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies. We're still with South Jersey's own Shawn Semple. And Brady LaDon, our social media coordinator and on-field MC, checking in with some questions from Instagram and Twitter. Brady, any more questions from the social media for Shawn?
Oh, absolutely. What is your favorite ballpark in minor league baseball? And more importantly, where is your favorite place to eat while on the road during the season?
Favorite place that I've played in minor league baseball so far has to be Hartford, Connecticut. That place was just next level. It just felt like you're in a pro park. And and I was like fresh moving up to Double A. So when we got there, it was like just, it was even like, just made the whole experience even better, because Hartford, when we were there, it was just a great fan, beautiful ballpark, you know, beautiful weather. Just honestly, that was definitely my favorite. And then, it's tough for the road. On the road, my favorite food. Well, see, I try to eat as well as I possibly can, because I'm not a big, I'm a big health nut. People might not know that, because I was pretty overweight when I was younger, so I never want to get there again. So I'm always conscious of what I eat. But on the road, peanut butter and jelly sandwich, I'm cool with it. I will crush about three of those a day, and I'll be absolutely fine.
That is awesome. Even
and that, the minor leagues, they call peanut butter and jelly a nice steak. So I enjoy three nice steaks a day while on the road.
I will say, I have gotten back into peanut butter and jelly these days also.
It fills you up. It's a quick little snack, and
slice of banana in the middle.
There you go.
Yeah.
Bananas.
Yeah, soup. It's actually like a really easy way to just sort of soak up a meal. And especially now that I'm like eating so many meals at home, which is weird because I never get to cook for myself or like eat at home during the season. So it's just like super easy and no cleanup.
Yeah. Well, usually whenever we're on the road, the only time I would ever eat for myself would be before we go to the park. And I would always try to find the best breakfast place I can. When I was in Florida, I would say my favorite road place to go to was a place called First Watch. I think they actually have some in the Northeast, but it's called First Watch. There's one in Tampa, and they're all over in Florida, but it's just a delicious breakfast place. And I get the chia seed pudding. I know it's what's wrong with me, but it's delicious.
I'm into that. Jeez, that sounds awesome.
It fills me up. It fills me up for like, I don't know. I could like literally go until dinner without eating after going there.
Yeah, I remember we had breakfast at the Sloppy Waffle in Hartford.
Next
door to the hotel there. That place is pretty good.
I enjoyed that very much. Yeah.
Little nubber out in front of the plate, off the bat of Chris Gittens. Pitcher up with it and tosses to first in time for the out. 3-2, Trenton leading here on Thursday Night Thunder here in the bottom of the fourth inning. Catcher Kellen Deglin coming to the plate.
Good, Deg. And that's just another great guy. And he has a child on the way. I love Deg. I saw him at Lululemon one time in Tampa, and we had a good conversation about, you know, he was in big league camp, and I was still in minor league camp. And we just got to chit-chatting in Lulu, and what a great guy. Like, no matter who you are, he just, like, he was my first roommate when I got to when I first got to Erie in Double A. That was my first time in Double A. He was my roommate. I never talked to him before. And he's a big dude. Like, kind of intimidating if you don't know who he is. I walk in, and he's on a PVC pipe on his back, like, rolling out. And he's like, what's up, man? I'm like, hey, like, I'm Shawn. He's like, hey, man, I'm Kellen. And, you know, just immediately, just a great guy. And we just got to chit-chatting for the rest of the year. He was my hotel roommate. Greg Weissert at the end of the year, too.
Oh, nice. That must have been a pair, you and Weissert.
He was fun. Honestly, like, he's hard to read, but a great guy. if you talk to anyone in the organization, he really is a great guy. He's just straight out of New York. Loves to tell you how
it is. Yeah, he just tells it like it is, you know, Long Island, and it's just how it goes,
just
man.
He just slings it. He absolutely slings it.
Shot into the left field corner off the bat of Max Burt. Boy, Max Burt still putting it together.
Let's go, Max.
I think Max Burt is a guest coming up here on Thursday Night Thunder. We got to get him on.
Yeah, he would be great. That's what you would call that hit right there would be gas. That's what you call gas. And Max Burt is CEO of That's Gas.
Really? I thought that was Matt Lifka.
Well, maybe. I don't know. I mean,
Lifka was more holy smokes.
Lifka was almost everything. He was the other guy I didn't know when I got to Double A, and I'm just like, who's this guy? And then all of a sudden, great locker guy. You know, just absolutely loved him. Got to get to know him a little bit more, and boy, did he make everyone on that team laugh every day.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I mean, it didn't matter time or place. You know, we could be on the bus after a tough loss, and he's just ripping and rolling. And, I miss that guy.
We got into Reading. We went from Akron to Reading, and we pulled up to the Reading Hotel about 4 o'clock in the morning. He was singing Ave Maria. sang the entire thing. The entire thing, like Step Brothers, like Brandon did, Will Ferrell did on Step Brothers. He did the entire thing before we got to the Reading Hotel, and it was one of the most impressive things I've ever have watched a man do.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
Fly out to deep right field off the bat of Angel Aguilar. 4 innings in the books here on Thursday Night Thunder. Trenton leads it 3-2.
Ballpark. Whose ballpark is this?
Well, it is not specifically Arm & Hammer Park. There's like a second deck hotel type deal happening on the first base side.
Maybe they're doing renovations in a couple of years and they're just not telling us in Thunder Park.
Could be. Could be. I mean, you never know.
Yeah.
Boy, Nick Nelson has settled in nicely since that second inning when he got touched up for a couple of runs.
That's what you gotta do as a pitcher. You gotta get into a spot where you can cruise and let your team just rack up some runs behind you, put them in a spot to win.
See some activity in that Thunder bullpen. Miguel Yajure and James Reeves working out of the bullpen, starting to get hot.
Talk about someone who had a fantastic, two people who had fantastic years last year, Yajure and Reeves, from both sides. Reeves, the southpaw slinger, just doesn't matter who it is, he's going to kill you. And then Yajure, who could throw any pitch wherever he wants.
I got to get to
know Yajure pretty well when I was in Tampa, and just a great kid, and one of the best throwing partners in the organization.
Interesting. What makes a good throwing partner for you?
Great to the chest every time. No movement with your pitches. Not saying movement with your pitches, but consistent movement with your pitches. Like if you're throwing with somebody, you always want to work on your curveball, your changeup, or something like that. Spin a couple. And the worst is when you have someone who just buries them, and you know, it gets you in the shin or gets you. You know, you're trying to block it up with your chest, but Yajure, it's like you put the glove there, and he's just gonna smack it every time. Good, yeah. And then he puts that on the mound. He just carves the whole time. Outside cutter, two seam in, change up, curveball. He's incredible.
There's a double deep into the alley in left center field, and the Rumble Ponies have the tying run in scoring position here in the fifth inning. A double from Austin Bosart.
It's funny that that we're watching this game and I saw Tebow come up. And I didn't want to interrupt you at the time, but Tebow was up, and I got the verse Tebow last year. And let's just say it's not in my favor. He ended up hitting the ground rule double off of me. First pitch.
Wow. Did you tell him it was coming?
I probably could have, honestly. And the thing is, though, like everyone, I read the reports before the game, and I knew to throw him breaking balls. I knew to throw him breaking balls, and I threw a first-pitch fastball with, I think there was two men on, too, so it was, like, just an ugly game. Not the best AAA debut, but sure was an eye-opener after the 8 runs in the first 3 innings.
Well,
but hey, you need those days to, you know, humble you and bring you back down to earth and, you know, start fresh again.
Miguel Yajure trying to keep this lead for the Thunder, facing the top of the order for the Rumble Ponies, Jacob Zanin at the plate.
My Apple Watch is telling me to stand up. Gotta love it. I don't work out with it on because I don't want it to ever, like I do like kettlebell stuff, so I don't want it to like flip off and like smash my watch face. So it's always like, hey, you could do it tomorrow. You could do it. It's like, shut up, I did it. I did it, Apple Watch.
I mean,
I actually just came from baseball and from working out. So I do my throwing and lifting. I do it from 10:30 to 12:30. And then, you know, got back here and hopped on with you guys.
Well, you know, so you've got the good rhythm down. I mean, you're not in South Jersey currently, right? Where are you at?
Oh, I'm at, so the last 2 years I've been living in Arkansas with my fiance.
Wonderful.
And we met in college in University of New Orleans in Louisiana. So, you know, wherever she is, and she works full-time. She actually is still working while all this is going on. Yeah, she works in marketing in a healthcare place. So, you know, they need the necessity people. But, you know, she's grinding, as what the Miley Grinders would say. She's grinding still. But she's doing good. But yeah, I live in Arkansas in the off season, but definitely miss the Northeast. But also, it's nice to be, you know, away from everyone and just to focus on what I gotta do.
Middle of the fifth inning here on Thursday Night Thunder. It's time now for our Brothers Pizza on Route 33 Pizza Toss.
Now it's time for the Brothers on Route 33 Pepperoni Toss. Ciao, Lisa.
Ciao, Lydia, and ciao, Thunder fans. This is the Brothers on Route 33 Pepperoni Toss. With me on this side, I have Team Pepperoni, and the third base side has Team Sausage. In 25 seconds, these teams are going to race to toss all their pepperoni into the pizza boxes, and the winners get a Brothers Pizza on Route 33 gift card. All right, Team Pepperoni and Team Sausage, pick up those pepperonis, and ready, set, toss them. We have meat flying all over the field down here. Two, three for Team Sausage on the third base side, and five for Team Pepperoni on this side. Five, four, three, two, one, and time. We have 9 for Team Pepperoni and 3 for Team Sausage. Congratulations, Team Pepperoni. You're the Brothers Pizza on Route 33 Pepperoni Toss winners.
Congratulations to the winning team. They've just won a $10 gift card towards a delicious Brothers Pizza.
Bottom of the fifth inning getting underway here on Thursday Night Thunder. Shawn Semple still with us. Brady Ladon is with us, our social media and on-field MC. Brady, any last questions for Shawn that came in through the socials?
Yeah, one more. It's a very specific question, and this comes from JimmyMac_18. What is your go-to pitch on a 3-2 count with runners in scoring position in the bottom of the ninth?
Hitters, tune out.
Fastball. Fastball coming. Trying to hit it. If you hit it, congrats. If you don't, I'm jumping 20 feet in the air and I'm running off that mound, evading that situation. Definitely 3-2. fastball, high cheddar. I'm trying to get up and in, and I'm trying to get them to swing right under it.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, I get it. You got to do it. You got to go with your best.
You got to go with your best pitch. Yeah, you got to go with your best pitch. Three, especially in that situation. Say if it was 3-2, man first, you know, 3-2, no one on. Maybe I'll give them a curveball, a changeup or something. But definitely 3-2, two outs, base is loaded, bottom ninth. I'm giving it the best fastball I had that entire day. It might not be the hardest one because, you know, I might be tired, but it also might be the hardest one. You never know.
Got to empty out that gas tank.
Yeah. And I got some thick legs, so they hold with me throughout the game pretty well.
How do you keep those legs in shape at, you know, during this time of year? Are there any activities or workouts that you're doing at home to keep your legs in shape?
So the big thing I've learned in the last year, I stopped doing like squats and benching. Well, not, I didn't stop doing them, but I only do it with one leg. So I isolate them. Ever since I started doing that is when I really saw the most power and explosiveness actually out of my legs, is doing like foot squats and side squats and lateral squats and whatever. So I don't do, I just do single leg squats and maybe really, help work my legs. I don't do too much running. I do more sprint work, because if you do a lot of long distance running, you actually end up breaking down the muscle in your leg. So, and actually, like, this year was a big year. It was really cool because they brought in Eric Cressy, who's a big isometric, very specific baseball type workout, which I do. So it was awesome when he came in here. We didn't have to do the 2 mile run, which is huge. Everyone hates doing the 2 mile run every year because no one runs, because it messes up our legs for pitching. You know, it stiffens us up. So yeah, I do isometric workouts. I do split squats and stuff, and then sprint work. Nothing more than 60 yards.
Bottom half of the fifth inning, Thunder in the lead 3-2 after the flyout by Trey Ambergee. Here's Estevan Florial with one away.
I love to see Flo having a good year.
First pitch, ground ball towards second. Andres Jimenez has it. Advancing to third is Zach Zehner.
Kingston. First time I saw, actually last year, so I know Flo was he was battling a little bit of some injuries last year, but he came back like right before the middle of the season, I think. And I was in Tampa when he first got there, and I never really got to see him play. And that man can fly. The reaction, off the bat, like the way he takes his route. He saved me a couple times deep in the gap last year. You know, tip of the cap. But great player, just powerful too. You know, like he is like a bigger guy, but like you wouldn't think that he's like gonna belt balls out. You'd see him speed out to a guy, but he hit a ball that first series I saw him play that just got, I think it got out in a matter of like 2 seconds. It was just a line drive. Actually, it might have went through the wall, not over. I don't.
You found a hole later?
Yeah.
Brandon Wagner takes a strike, count 3-1.
I'm surprised Giddy didn't make any holes in Trenton last year.
Oh, man. Yeah, me too.
He was playing wall ball. I just know the ball doesn't travel too well in Trenton, but hey, that's good for me at least. But the hitters, yeah. The thing is though, the hitting coordinators know if a ball is going to go out or not in Yankee Stadium. You know, they compare it, so they're not comparing it to how many home runs you hit at Trenton. They're seeing how far you hit the ball and if it goes out in Yankee Stadium. So yeah, that's cool too.
Brandon Wagner just narrowly missing a second home run as he pulls that one foul. Yeah, you know, Shawn, it's the nature of the Delaware River in right field as Wagner takes on the inside corner, and that strike three.
Low.
Tough call for Brandon Wagner, but nothing tough about the time we got to spend with you tonight, Shawn Semple. Much appreciated, my friend. It's great to catch up with
you. I love baseball. I miss baseball. So this has been a great time to just kind of connect with some baseball people and chit-chat about it.
Thursday Night Thunder continues next. Thursday Night Thunder continues. The Thunder leading the Binghamton Rumble Ponies 3-2 here in the top half of the sixth inning. And we have a couple of very special guests with us here for this inning, Mr. Tom Smith and Bat Boy Tommy Smith. Tommy, it's great to hear from you.
Yeah.
How you doing, John?
Well, you know, all things considered, Tom, I think we're doing pretty good. We're watching a little bit of baseball. The Binghamton Rumble Ponies are playing against the Thunder. Tim Tebow is in the game for Binghamton. Tommy, do you remember seeing and meeting Tim Tebow a couple years ago?
Yeah.
What was it like to meet him?
Yeah. We went up there, John. When he met him, you remember the story of how he got him to change uniforms right before the game back in here in Trenton. But then we went up to Binghamton, and Tommy worked for the Binghamton team. You remember that, Tom? Tim Tebow had just broken his wrist or something and just was going for he hurt his hand, right?
Yeah.
But he waited for us to come up and so he could see Tommy in the clubhouse before the game actually started, and that was kind of nice.
Yeah, that was actually one of the best moments. I was reflecting on that with Shawn Semple earlier today. And actually we visited, you know, Shawn Semple was on for the first couple innings of this game. And, you know, just the time with Tim Tebow seemed like so much fun. And it's hard to believe that it's 2 years ago now.
Yeah.
Yeah, that went by. He was your friend, right, Tom?
Yeah.
So, Tom, what is sort of life like for you these days? I know that you're an attorney by trade, and I imagine you're working remotely like many of us.
Now, Tom, you're waiting for the Yankees. He was asking, John was asking me how I do with work. So I'm doing our office is closed, John. So I can go in there and get the mail and look for things, administrative things to do, but I have my practice is limited to speaking with clients on the phone, and the courts are still operating by remote video. So I've argued motions over this technology, the Zoom, and I've also been in a deposition with other lawyers and witnesses.
We've got a double here down the left field line by Ronnie Mauricio, and now at the plate for the Rumble Ponies is Tim Tebow. Boy, it even looks like Tim with that thick build and left-handed batting stance.
Yeah, look at that. Tom Tebow's up.
Yeah, he is.
Looks just like him, right?
Yeah, Tebow, yeah. Yeah.
Think he's going to get a hit?
Yeah.
You're rooting for the Thunder, all right?
Pitch in the dirt is blocked by Trenton's catcher Kellen Deglin, and the count is 2 balls and no strikes.
It's really funny how much excitement Tim Tebow brings whatever park he's in.
Yeah, you know, certainly one of a kind as a human being. And, you know, you guys got to meet him and talk to him a little bit. And I just remember dealing with with all of the media around the Eastern League All-Star Game when, you know, he was a starter and in the All-Star Game that year. That was one of the longest professional days of my life. And I got a couple chance. I got, you know, sort of at the end of the day when Tebow was packing his stuff, heading out to leave after the game, I got a chance to just sort of hang out with him for a couple minutes while they, you know, got the car situation for him to get out of town as Tebow goes down on strikes here to end the top of the sixth inning. And I was struck by just how nice he was to everybody he came in contact with.
I'll tell you just a quick story about that All-Star game. It was, Tommy and I were just actually watching it on YouTube the other day. And so that day that we were in the, I was sitting in the box for a little bit, and my daughters were with us sitting behind me. And Mike Dill had gotten a picture of Tommy and Tim Tebow taken earlier in the year, and he got it autographed by Tim and had given it to me at the game. And I was showing my daughters behind me, and sitting behind them apparently was Tim Tebow's sisters and his Tim's agent, which now is the general manager of the Mets. So they saw the picture and they started asking my daughters how they knew Tommy, et cetera. And they got all excited. They wanted to get Tommy's autograph, and the owner of the team happened to be sitting there as well. And he got involved in the conversation. And then he invited us up to Binghamton to do a game that Tommy would work for the Binghamton team. And so we took him up on it. A couple of weeks later, we went up to Binghamton and they actually played the Thunder. So that's how that came about.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So I didn't know the background to that story. That is very cool.
Yeah.
His
sisters were really nice. And I didn't talk much with his agent, but he seemed to be nice as well at the time.
Chris Gittens is at the plate for the Thunder now with one away here in the bottom half of the sixth inning. Binghamton right-hander Matt Blackham giving some relief here for the Rumble Ponies. First pitch to Gittens is fouled away off to the first base side for strike one.
Yeah.
Chris had a big year last year.
Yeah, the Eastern League's MVP. Another good friend of yours, right, Tommy?
Yeah.
You remember you remember giving him hugs? He got a lot of home runs last year. Did he get hurt last year? I know he was hurt the year before. What does John remember?
Gittens is down on strikes here, but Chris, he missed a lot of the 2018 season, but actually played just about the full year in 2019, and it was a season to remember for sure. Here's Kellen Deglin at the plate for the Thunder.
Kellen's a heck of a golfer. Did you know that, Sean?
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, I had a chance to play with him this last summer. And he's a really nice guy, I'm sure you know.
Oh, yeah. Kellen's a good friend and was with us for the first week of Thursday Night Thunder when we debuted this back on April 2nd.
Is that right? It's funny that every time I see him, he calls me Mr. Smith, and I can think, geez, I'm not that old. I guess I am.
Yeah, you mad old guy.
Thanks, Tom.
Two balls and one strike on Kellen Deglin. The next pitch to him is swung on and rocketed foul down the right field line for strike two.
There was a couple of good golfers with the Thunder. The former pitching coach, Tim.
Tim Norton.
Tim Norton was a good player.
Yeah. Tim Norton and I played quite a bit on the road the last 2 years.
Is that right?
He's a lot of fun to play with, and he can really hit the ball.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Two out walk drawn by Kellen Deglin. Third baseman Max Burt is up next for the Thunder. And speaking of golf, Max Burt is also a very good golfer. He actually played golf when he was in high school and played baseball, because golf was actually a fall sport where he went to school in Massachusetts.
Wow. Now he was just up for a little bit last year, right?
Yeah, part of the championship team, hung in for the end of the season, but played only less than 30 regular season games with the Thunder. Count 2-0 against him.
Yeah.
Tommy's tried golf a couple of times.
Oh, that must have been a lot of fun.
I love calling my team, my weapon.
You got to keep your head down, right, Tom?
Yeah, but my eye down. That is home.
End of the sixth inning. It is 3-2 Trenton. Tommy, Tom Smith, it was great to visit with you guys. Thanks for taking some time with us tonight on Thursday Night Thunder.
Thanks for having us, Sean. It was fun. Thanks.
Thursday Night Thunder, presented by NJM Insurance, continues as we enter the top half of the seventh inning. Thunder in the lead, 3-2. Miguel Yajure still on the mound for the Thunder, facing third baseman Shervin Newton to begin this inning. And joining us for the rest of the way here, a couple of members of the Trenton Thunder front office, John Bodnar and Seth English, a couple of guys who work in our ticket office and lead the group sales department. And, you know, this is just sort of a fun time for all of us now that we're watching baseball for a few minutes here, as Newton lifts one to left field, and that one is caught by Trey Ambergy for the first out here in the seventh inning. And John Bodnar, I guess we'll start with you. You know, you've been working for the team since 2015, but, you know, what inspired you to work in baseball?
Yeah, I mean, growing up in South Jersey, I've, you know, always been a huge sports fan, you know, across the board, Philadelphia, the 4 for 4, as they say. But, you know, baseball was always a first love. I grew up going to Trenton Thunder games, especially. You know, my favorite player going back is Nomar Garcia Parra, and that's because of the days in Trenton. You know, seeing those guys and seeing Boomer run around, I have pictures. And when I first started with the Thunder, my dad was always like, oh, you got to bring this in, or you got to bring this old giveaway or this old stuffed Boomer and leave it at your desk. And I'm like, all right, Dad, like, you know, I'm 20, 23, 24 years old. I'm not going to bring in a stuffed animal. But, you know, baseball was always something I wanted to definitely get into. And, you know, really before even knowing kind of how a minor league baseball team operated, you know, I had the goal of you know, wanting to be a major league baseball general manager, as so many people do after playing MVP baseball 2005, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I still do that too. And I actually do that on Out of the Park Baseball 2021, which is an awesome baseball simulation game, which you can play on your computer. So if you want to be a GM and GM the Phillies, you can do it on Out of the Park Baseball.
It's funny you bring that up, because just this week I broke out my old MLB Showdown cards. I'm not sure if you remember that game, from about like 2000 to 2005, I think. And I spent a few hours playing last night, and it's definitely taken up a chunk of my time while we've been in quarantine. You know, just being able to play some games. I created a couple expansion teams, you know, just, you know, really getting into my childhood a little bit.
Jacob Zanna now at the plate for Binghamton after the double by Binghamton catcher Austin Bosart. Thunder leading this one 3-2 in the top half of the seventh inning. A 3-run home run by Brandon Wagner in the first inning is standing tall on the scoreboard right now. Miguel Yajure still working in relief here. His pitch, a curveball that drops in for a strike. Not a lot of speed at second base with the catcher running. Another curveball from Yajure drops in, and the count is 0-2. Thunder trying to hang on to another win here as they work into late May here in MLB The Show. 0-2 pitch, curveball that bites outside for ball one. Here's a 1-2 offering, and that one is swung on and lined into right field. It drops for a base hit. Stopping at third is Bosart, and a base hit for Jacob Zanin puts men on the corners for Binghamton. Well, you know, Seth English, you're also with us here on Thursday Night Thunder. Where are you from, and sort of how did you start to get into working in baseball as the Thunder go to the bullpen here with left-hander Trevor Lane?
Well, so I'm originally from Maryland, but I spent most of my time growing up in South Carolina. Actually, the first job I had in sports was for a wood bat summer league college team called the Columbia Blowfish. It was named after Hootie and the Blowfish. And I was most of the time the mascot down there.
Is the mascot a blowfish?
Yeah, I can send a picture over your way to put into the game after this pitch, I guess. You know, overlay it nicely right here. But I was dressed up as a blowfish, and then I worked my way up to short season single A with the State College Spikes and caught on with them full time. So I started like way at the bottom.
One ball and two strikes with men on the corners. Trevor Lane trying to get out of a jam for the Thunder here in the seventh. Check on the base runner at first. Oh, but the throw skips away, but not far enough for the man to score. Throw to second is in time, and the Thunder get out of the inning. Excellent strike from first baseman Brandon Wagner. Middle of the seventh inning here at Arm & Hammer Park. It is time now for God Bless America and Take Me Out to the Ballgame.
Fans, thank you. Please continue standing and help us honor the United States of America as the Steinert High School and Reynolds Middle School choirs perform God Bless America.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the
stretch out and sing along with Our Lady of Sorrows Bell Choir to Take Me Out to the Ball Game.
Thursday Night Thunder continues here as we enter the bottom half of the seventh inning. Well, a couple of great performances there in the middle of the seventh. And feels like it's a Hamilton Day redux going on here. A couple of Hamilton Township area groups performing tonight. Seth English and John Bodnar of our ticket department, members of our front office now for a couple of years with us as we wrap up Thursday Night Thunder here in the bottom of the seventh inning. And Seth, you were telling us some about your experience, but you know, why specifically did you want to work in baseball?
Well, at first I didn't. I wanted to work in the live event industry, more on the concert side of things. And then I did the internship for the Blowfish down in South Carolina and just fell in love with the experience for the fans.
Swing and a miss by Angel Aguilar, and there's one away here in the seventh inning. What would you say is one of the favorite parts of your job, Seth?
Growing close with coworkers, I would say. I mean, you really get to know everyone you work with in a way that I assume other people don't at their other jobs. I mean, we spend like, 14 hours a day together at points during the season. So, you get to have a lot of fun with people.
Max Burt, the batter for the Thunder, no balls and one strike. Pitch to him, a swing and a miss for strike two. Thinking about new floors for your home? Request a free estimate from Rich's Carpet One Floor and Home with one of their flooring experts today. And swing by their store on Route 33 in Hamilton Township. You can also discover their whole lineup and products of home solutions at richescarpetone.com. Trey Ambergy batting now for the Thunder, two away here in the bottom half of the seventh inning. Thunder leading this one 3-2. Pitch is swung on and tomahawked foul for strike one. All right, favorite moment from the 2019 season for either of you, John or Seth?
John, you can go ahead. I think you were actually at the game where we won the championship, so I'm imagining that's part of it, right?
Yeah, absolutely. You took the words right out of my mouth. After being so close for the past few years, you know, making the playoffs and then the disappointment of not seeing the team pull through, taking the trip down to Bowie last year and watching that team, I mean, I've seen a lot of talent, just like you have, John, come through. Aaron Judge, Gary Sanchez, Gleyber Torres, and you know, none of those teams were able to get us over the edge. You know, I just feel like last year was a great group of guys that just seemed to have a lot of fun, and it was great seeing them push it over the edge.
Round out here to end the inning off the bat of Esteban Florial. We head to the eighth inning here on Thursday Night Thunder. Designated hitter Jeremy Vasquez will lead off the inning for the Rumble Ponies here on the eighth, 2-3-4 in Binghamton's lineup. As we enter the top half of the eighth inning, Trenton still hanging on to that one-run lead. The three-run home run by Brandon Wagner back in the first inning, still standing up on the board. Rumble Ponies got a couple runs back in the second inning off Nick Nelson. But Thunder put up a whole bunch of zeros since then. Trevor Lane continuing a full inning of relief. His first offering is outside to Jeremy Vasquez. Any favorite games that you attended last year, Seth?
Just for the Thunder games, I look at the Education Day. I think it was the Camp Day back in July last summer, where it rained while we were delivering lunches down to the groups. Those days are usually pretty hectic for us, just as far as the work we have to do. So that one stands out to me just because it was so crazy. I know I was supposed to go to, I think, a Phillies Braves game when we ended up winning the championship. I tried to convince one of my friends to take the drive down to Bowie, but he didn't want to jump off of a plane and hop right down into a car for 4 hours.
I can't imagine why, as the left fielder Trey Hamburgy makes the catch. Here comes Daniel Alvarez out of the Thunder bullpen to try to finish off this eighth inning.
And the funny thing about that was the weather that day was slightly rainy, so his flight ended up getting delayed to the point where we actually missed that game as well. So I started getting blown up with texts from everybody who was down in Bowie celebrating on the field and popping champagne. I was just in my apartment.
I'm not sure that's a favorite memory. Seems like a sad story, actually.
Actually, I think it's perfect. That's the way I think things usually end up going for me in minor league baseball. I wouldn't change any part of that.
Middle of the eighth inning, as Daniel Alvarez gets the final couple outs, we head to the bottom of the eighth. It's 3-2 Trenton. Riley Gilliam on the mound now for the Binghamton Rumble Ponies, an ace reliever for Binghamton, one of the top relievers in the Eastern League a season ago. Trenton leading Binghamton 3-2 here on Thursday Night Thunder, presented tonight by NJM Insurance. Brandon Wagner leading off the inning. First baseman, first pitch swinging, grounds one back through the middle for a base hit.
John, you had asked about, favorite memories and I think one of the reasons that the championship run was so special for, a lot of us was that team seemed to stay together for a lot of the year. I had the opportunity to go to the All-Star game in Richmond, and all of our All-Stars were critical parts of that championship team, including Hoy Park, who had that big steal home during the championship run. So I think that kind of made it special too, with the minor leagues, guys constantly going up and down. We got to see the team kind of stay together and see the whole thing come to fruition.
Yeah. I've gotten that question a couple times, since the season ended and, sort of in the immediate aftermath of the championship series, was there ever a moment that you knew this team was going to be really good? And I was like, well, sure. I mean, there was the win the night before Mother's Day, where Zach Zehner led a 5-run comeback in the 12th inning with a 2-run walk-off triple. Just sort of guys, as you talked about, John, just sort of hung in the whole year. And then, when the roster moves came through for September 1st, and there's always a trickle-down effect to Double-A. And, you know, most of the key guys stuck on the roster, Chris Gittens, Kyle Holder, Hoy Park. And, you know, it was that moment that I said to myself, you know, we've actually got a pretty good shot at this. And, you know, it just sort of turned out to be true because the team could really pitch. And, you know, guys like Clark Schmidt, and, you know, then you get an army of rehabs in the last 2 weeks. And this makes it a little bit easier.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. You know, every year I kind of go in, you know, we always on the ticket side of things focus more on, you know, what's going on off the field than really on the field. And I always ask you, I'm like, okay, how are we going to finish? It feels like, and you know, when I know and I recognize some of the talent that we're going to have, I'm always like, oh yeah, like this is going to be the year, like my first year when, you know, I walk in the building and it's guys like Aaron Judge, Gary Sanchez, Luis Severino on the roster. I'm like, okay, Like this is how it's going to be year after year. You know, and then last year, some of the guys had, you know, carried over from the previous season. And it was just like, okay, like this is just kind of the double A roster and, you know, they're going to be okay. But, you know, seeing it all come about and then, you know, being in year, that was season 5 for me, and just capping it off with a win. You know, it's special and you know, you don't forget it and you don't forget those moments, especially being with, at the game with coworkers, fellow coworkers, you know, and being able to go down onto the field and into the clubhouse and seeing, you know, that the players are just so excited about, you know, winning and what's going on and the buy-in that those guys have too. And just the fight every day when they go out there.
Thunder with a real opportunity here in the bottom of the 8th inning as Chris Gittens works a walk. And now here is Kellen Deglin with a couple ducks on the pond. Deglin, the postseason most valuable player last year for his contributions behind the plate and at the plate. A big home run in game 4 of the championship series. Takes the first pitch outside for ball 1. Next offering to Deglin is just inside, and Riley Gilliam really fighting himself here. Missing out of the zone. Back-to-back pitches with the bases loaded.
A little insurance would be nice here.
Gilliam ready. And the right-hander fires. Deglin swings through a fastball at 95. Two balls and 1 strike. The offering home. A swing and a miss. Gilliam really ramping it up there. Up to 97 with the heater. Nice view of Arm & Hammer Park. Deglin trying to win this battle. 2-2 pitch to him. Rides up and outside for ball 3.
This guy looks like me playing this game.
3-2 pitch. Swung on and grounded to second. They come home with it for 1. Return throw to first base is in time for a double play. Is that how it looks when you play, Seth?
Pretty much. I'm in a custom league with a few people that also work in the sport industry. My team is 1-6. So...
Wow.
Good thing I'm not on the sticks for this one.
Is MLB The Show your best game, Seth, or are you better at a different video game?
I'm better at Madden. I love playing the football game. And with that, I'm still not among the top 3 players in the league that I'm in for that as well. So I'm not a huge gamer.
Maybe we should get on some Call of Duty Warzone when this all wraps up. Pitch to Max Burns, a breaking ball strike.
Not quite good at Call of Duty either. Now, Tony Hawk Pro Skater, you know, undefeated in that.
Here's an 0-2 pitch to Burt. He swings and misses for strike 3. Riley Gilliam dances around all kinds of trouble in the 8th inning. Bases loaded, nobody out, and nobody scores for Trenton. We go to the 9th with the Thunder leading by a run. Right-hander Brooks Kreske will enter, looking for his 15th save of the season, trying to close the door on yet another Trenton Thunder victory here on Thursday Night Thunder, presented by NJM Insurance. From professional builders to the regular guy, Heath Lumber Company should be your first choice for home improvement supplies and service that is too good to be true. Located only 4 miles from Arm & Hammer Park in lovely Ewing, New Jersey, visit Heath Lumber, your complete home building center since 1857. John Bodnar and Seth English, a couple members of the Thunder front office with us here on Thursday Night Thunder. And, you know, I think both of you sort of have notable first games that you worked when you joined the Thunder front office. And John, we can start with you. Take us through that first game that you worked as a member of the Thunder front office.
Yeah, so that would have been 2015. Judge walked us off in a thrilling fashion. Still one of my favorite moments of all time. You know, thinking back, because Adam's call was just incredible, and we talk about it and joke about it in the office to this day. But like I said before, the talent on that team was awesome. I hate to say it. I always thought Greg Bird was going to be the top guy there. But no, I mean, just seeing that walk-off home run and the excitement, we use that that picture for everything that we do. But yeah, I mean, it was exciting. It would have been exciting had it been, you know, a blowout, but you know, to walk it off and the way Judge did it was absolutely incredible.
Tim Tebow at the plate now facing Kriske, and the fastball is in there for a strike. There's one away here in the top of the ninth. Seth, what was your first game that you worked for the Thunder front office?
Well, it's pretty appropriate. Tim Tebow's batting. It was actually the 2018 All-Star game. Where Tebow was down there, and I've never, you know, I worked short season before I came here, and the first two games or events that I worked for the Thunder was the home run derby and autograph signing, and then the All-Star game itself. So to see Tebow mania running wild, you know, I guess as he hits a single here, I'm not really a color guy, but he hit a single here, and he did okay in the All-Star game, if I remember correctly, but that was my first game. There was pandemonium everywhere.
Yeah, I remember Tebow had a double in his first at bat as this ball is lifted to right field off the bat of Shervin Newton and brought in by the right fielder Zach Zehner. And you know, I remember Tebow had a double in the first at bat that he had in that game. He was the DH for the Eastern Division team and came up again in the ninth inning because, you know, of course, the All-Star game was tied in the ninth inning after an RBI double from Trey Ambergy. And Tebow came up with Ambergy on second base and struck out against Harrisburg reliever Derek Self in what could have been a walk-off win for the Eastern Division and would have been a memory for the ages.
Didn't they go – they did a home run derby instead of extra innings, right?
Right, yeah, because, you know, there's always so many pitchers available for an All-Star game. We had that special hitting challenge, which I was literally Googling the rules for on the spot, on the air, after the final out was caught. Here's a fly ball to deep center, and there to make the catch is Estevan Florial, and the Thunder win 3-2, a victory tonight over the Binghamton Rumble Ponies, Julio Mosquera. And his staff celebrating another victory. Our thanks to Kia for presenting tonight's starting lineups. Our thanks to NJM Insurance for presenting Thursday Night Thunder tonight. Our thanks to Shawn Semple, Batboy Tommy, Front Office Associates John Bodnar, and Seth English for joining us. And thank you. Stay healthy. Stay safe, everyone. And we'll see you next week on Thursday Night Thunder.